Very good morning to you all today. Welcome back after a long weekend. It's good to see your beaming and rejuvenated faces. A long summer dry spell does beg for some respite. As you can see, it's not raining outside. But let's make a little drizzle. Let's make a little shower and a cathartic downpour. I'd like to invite you this morning to do something called as body percussion. We try to do something called as a rainstorm. Before I explain the four steps that we're about to do, I request you to sit straight and with your feet firmly on the floor. Am I audible back there?
Yes.
Yeah. There are four steps that we need to follow. The first step is rubbing our palms together vigorously. The second step is to click our fingers together. The third step is to tap or clap our thighs. And the fourth step is to stamp our feet like our life depended on it. If you were to close your eyes and listen to these sounds, it should sound like the pitter-patter of rainfall, which soon becomes a crescendo of downpour. So without further ado, let's put our hands together and begin. A little more vigorously. Say goodbye to the rain. All right. Let's treat ourselves now to a quote by Viktor Frankl. The significance of these words will be further conveyed to you by Nirmal sir.
Good morning, sir. Good morning, ma'am. Good morning, everyone present here. Thank you, Sakshi. This is a presentation on Good Friday. And you all know Jesus was actually Son of God. So it was God who had sent him to enlighten the world. So that is how the saying goes. As Sakshi rightly says, what is to give light must endure burning. So you all know that the most significant thing in Christendom is crucifixion of Christ and his resurrection. Those are like the basic framework of Christian ritual and ethics. So this is what it suggests, like Jesus who endured burning. Actually, he sacrificed his life for the human betterment, for the human goodness. We'll go ahead. Okay, it says it is finished. Now, actually, if you see historically, Jesus was born sometime in 4 BC. And by that time, the prevailing world in Mediterranean, in North Africa, was actually all Judaism. What you have, the Jews population, like Einstein, then Steven Spielberg, the great filmmaker, they all belong to the Jews community. And the Jews were actually, they believe that a few important things. They believe that God is actually infinite. God cannot be put in a, any expression, any representation, cannot be finite. And God is God has chosen them as the few people who are going to bring good being for the whole world. So in fact, when Jesus came up with his preachings, with his sermons, that was like he was sent by God and for the betterment for the humankind. So that was actually contrary to the prevailing Judaism and Roman Empire. So if you see the initial days of Christian, Jesus, you will find actually Jesus was, Jesus and his followers, his disciples, they were being troubled by the Jews as well as the Roman Empire, the guards, the governors. So his basic sermons say actually it is finished. So that means it's going to have the finish of the human errors, the human jealousy, the human anger, the human limitations, and it's going to now have the kingdom of God. So we all actually live in the kingdom of God. That's if you place a bit of faith in how Christianity came up and with Jesus, so you will understand this. Now, Sakshi, even you can add a few things.
So we'd like to paint a timeline of the last few days of Jesus and why it is so important in history, in the history of Christianity.
I'll share a parallel of Jesus' birth with Lord Krishna's birth. You'll see both were being born in a very difficult situation. You all know the story of Krishna being, in the prison where he was born, and you know the miracles like the guards went to sleep, and then his parents' hands were in iron chains. They all got free, and then how he was being taken to Gokul actually. So similarly, you will find Jesus was actually born in a stable, and his mother was a virgin, Virgin Mary. Now it is only possible to know if you leave aside logic, and if you actually take faith as a way of knowing, and then you can actually kind of make out how it must be actually. So as I told, Jesus was knowing that he was sent by God for the betterment of human being, and to abolish all the human wrath, the anger, the jealousy. So when he grew up, at one point of time, he kneels down, he washes the feet of his disciples, and that's what you see over here. Sakshi,
especially before the Last Supper, he actually wanted to show humility and that he is as common as his disciples. And on the Last Supper, he had already had a premonition that he would be deceived by one of his disciples. But despite that, he did not hold any feelings of animosity. He, with true devotion, washed the feet of each one of his disciples. He shared the last meal with them. A bread called Eucharist was shared, and he also shared wine with them, which was a symbol of what he's about to sacrifice, which is his real flesh and blood for all of humanity.
Yes, the garden thing.
So having known after this Last Supper that he will be betrayed, he goes, after his disciples fall off to sleep, Jesus actually goes to the Garden of Gethsemane and prays to the Almighty that, it's moments before I will be betrayed by my disciple. He even knew it was going to be Judas. And soon after, Judas follows and plants a kiss on his cheek, and he's arrested by the Roman guards.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah, you see here, his enemies were actually the Roman, they catch him. They take him to the hill where he was being crucified.
There's a hill called Calvary, an execution hill, where they executed most of the criminals. He was betrayed by his disciples, denied, spat on. Go ahead, sir.
Right. You see the throne over there, like as I told, like his preachings were against Judaism. So therefore Jesus was actually born at Nazareth. And these Roman guards, they put this thorny crown over his head, if you remember the Christ symbol, and they made fun of him as the king of Nazareth. And this is what the crown is. And then they mocked at him, and he was convicted, actually, because the religious leaders, the Jews' religious leaders, they could not accept the fact that Jesus wants to claim himself as the Son of God. And they were actually in a fearful stage, that it seems Jesus was going to prepare an army and to take over the Jewish kingdom and was going to be the king. Actually, nothing of that sort was there in his aims. It is something again similar to if you go to Krishna's days, like his mama, his maternal uncle was actually the one who was prevailing all the evils, and he as God only took birth on the surface of earth for bringing justice, for bringing goodness for the humankind, and that is what is similar with Jesus also. So here Jesus was being convicted, and he was being given the death punishment for to be crucified along with two other criminals. He was during those days, the practice used to be like before crucifixion, the person used to be tied on an anvil and used to kneel down and stand, and the guards used to flog, like putting those big bars with nails, and they are being tied to the strings, with thick threads, and they used to flog, and that is how the convict goes emasculated, like with less of power, and that is how he was been then freed and was been taken to carry his own cross and go to the hill, as Sakshi right now told us, and used to be crucified over there. So this is how they took him to outside the walls of Jerusalem, and the hill actually resembles like that of a skull cap, and that is where usually the convicts used to be crucified. So Jesus along with two other criminals, they were all three of them were being crucified there. So this is something very uncommon, and it is definitely not possible for any human being. When you are being pained, and how you can come up with this divine statement which says that Father, please forgive them, and they do not know actually what actions they are doing. I think this is what makes, and yesterday I was reading near about 2.2 billion people as the follower of Christianity. I think that that sacrifice, that message of God probably makes people deeply believe in the religion. And again, just to add, I was reading Judaism along with being a Hindu, again, many things that we know from our childhood days. In fact, it's all branches from the same tree, and actually God wants probably to have certain differentiation. Somewhere he takes birth as Krishna, somewhere he takes birth as Jesus, and probably so that we know each other better, probably, because if we all would have been same, probably we would not have been knowing each other well. So probably the difference makes us understand each other better. So this is what Jesus says. And then, Sakshi, if you can contribute a little.
So, God actually had wrath and sadness. So, the entire valley fell dark. And it was then that people realized what they had done. And there was a Roman guard which actually said he was, in past tense, the Son of God. So it is said that he bled for humanity, he died for humanity, for our sins, and he took the punishment even though we were sinful. And he restored our peace and to all of humanity. And his last words before he died were, "It is finished," that the debt of humanity has been, we have been absolved of all of our sins because of this one action. I'd like to invite my friends now for two soulful renditions. Ophelia ma'am, Fiona ma'am, Rosemary ma'am, and Dion, please join us. You'd like mine?
Ma'am, one of you can use this.
To
Thank you so much. It was wonderful. After this wonderful hymns, or after these wonderful hymns, I'd like to present a wonderful video, something that explains us why this day could be called Good Friday.
Good Friday. How can one describe such a day? The wrongdoing of all humanity, putting to an end an innocent man, the Son of God. This is the story of Jesus' death by way of a cross, all in one moment bringing death to the bright light of our future. He never stopped loving us, and yet this is the incredible part of it. Our sin stopped his heart. Our sin drove the nails firmly in the hands of God. All along, these were the plans. We told ourselves that we were in control, and this was deemed sufficient for all of us. The brutal beating, the inhuman flogging, the naked humiliation. Heaven watched and saw it all. Our rebellion, our guilt, our shame, erasing the very notion of reconciling us with God, our sin and our debt, overcoming Jesus. Here is our King, obliterated. The enemy laughing, his plans unstoppable. There's no longer the sound of freedom rising. Now God's people are utterly broken. Behold the chains of mortality. Yes, this is what is true. We had heard the stories of old. The lost are found, the blind can see, the weak are made strong. But now, we are witnesses to this reality. God is dead. We'd almost believed there is a way of redemption, there is a life of fulfillment, there is a peace beyond understanding. Now we know better. For us, we can say that God is encapsulated in this one realization. The single greatest sacrifice in human history is finished. How clearly we can see it. So what's so good about Good Friday? Just one thing, that the blood of Jesus can reverse the curse of sin and raise the dead to life. How clearly we can see, it is finished. The single greatest sacrifice in human history encapsulated in this one realization. We can say that God is for us. Now we know better. There is a peace beyond understanding. There is a life of fulfillment. There is a way of redemption. We had almost believed God is dead, but now we are witnesses to this reality. The weak are made strong. The blind can see. The lost are found. We had heard the stories of old. Yes, this is what is true. The chains of mortality utterly broken. Behold, freedom rising. Now God's people are unstoppable. There's no longer the sound of the enemy laughing. His plans obliterated. Here is our King, Jesus, overcoming our sin and our debt, reconciling us with God, erasing the very notion of our rebellion, our guilt, our shame. Heaven watched and saw it all, the naked humiliation, the inhuman flogging, the brutal beating, and this was deemed sufficient for all of us. We told ourselves that we were in control. All along, these were the plans firmly in the hands of God. Our sin drove the nails, our sin stopped his heart, and yet this is the incredible part of it. He never stopped loving us. The bright light of our future all in one moment, bringing death to death by way of a cross. This is the story of Jesus, the Son of God, an innocent man putting to an end the wrongdoing of all humanity. How can one describe such a day? Good Friday.
There's a quote by Viktor Frankl which says, between stimulus and response, there is a space. This quote reminds me of a story I read as a child by Gulzar called Michelangelo. And in the story, Michelangelo was given the task by Pope Julius to paint the Sistine Chapel. Now, Michelangelo found it very difficult to paint by imagination, so he needed real-life models to inspire him. And he looked for the face of baby Jesus to paint the nativity scene. And he found this young cherub in the middle of the streets of Rome. And he was happy that he was able to find the face of infant Jesus as inspiration. A few years passed. Later, he was given the task to paint the Last Supper in the Sistine Chapel. But he found it very difficult to imagine the face of the man who betrayed all of humanity, the face of Judas. Having almost reached the end of his tether, one day outside a pub, he finds the disheveled, uncouth man, and he decides, well, this is the face of Judas, and I can paint him as the face of Judas. And he succeeds in painting the Last Supper. Well, what he realized on the day that Last Supper was finished, when the model Judas was leaving, the model Judas asked him, do you remember the name of the child who played infant Jesus, or who portrayed infant Jesus? And Michelangelo responds, well, yes, his name is Marcellini. What the model of Judas did after that was rolled up his sleeve only to reveal a tattoo which said Marcellini. He was the face of infant Jesus in childhood. What I'm trying to tell you with this, or what Gulzar was trying to tell us a long time back, is that Judas and Jesus are within us, and it is for us to decide who we want to be. With this, I would like to lead us into a small meditation called As Breath as Anchor. It's a mindfulness practice which helps us find strength within during moments of difficulty. Anchoring is a practice like a ship at sea, deserted in the middle of storm, finds strength only within itself through its own weight by anchoring itself. Breath as anchor can help us find a little bit of stability to diffuse what is bothering us. I'm just going to read out a chant. This is by a Vietnamese monk called Thich Nhat Hanh. It goes as in, out. You need to breathe in and exhale. And how do you need to breathe? It's deeply and slowly. And if you breathe in deeply and slowly, you will be at calm, you'll be at ease. And whatever you're holding on to, you need to smile and then let go by saying release. The first word connotes us breathing in, and the second is for us to exhale. To make it easier, I'm going to play a chant, and you can do it along with it. Second video. In out.
In out. Present moment, wonderful moment. Come in.
Thank you so much for being a great audience. I would like to call Kamini ma'am and Madhulika ma'am to the mic now.
Good morning, everyone. Today, me and Kamini ma'am, we both are here to give a presentation on Holi, the most colorful of all the Indian festivals. Holi, the festival of colors, also called Holika, Fagwa, and Dulandi. Holi is a very famous Hindu festival. It is celebrated all over the country and also by Indians who are settled abroad. Holi generally falls in the month of Feb or March. It is celebrated on the Purnima of Hindu lunar calendar month of Phagun. This year Holi is on 24th of March, coming Thursday. Significance of Holi, like every other festival, Holi also has its own significance. It is celebrated to welcome the new seasons, starting with spring, to reset and renew the relationships and end old conflicts. It also means sacrifice. We should burn all the impurities of our mind and soul through the fire of devotion and knowledge. There are several stories related to the origin of Holi. The first and foremost is the story of Prahlad. He was the son of King Hiranyakashipu. The king demanded that everyone in his kingdom should worship him as God, but his own son Prahlad refused to do so. Instead, he became a great devotee of Lord Vishnu. Disgusted by this gesture of his son, the king ordered him to be killed. He ordered his sister Holika to enter a blazing fire with Prahlad in her lap. Holika had a boon which made her immune to fire. The story goes that when Holika entered the fire, Lord Vishnu himself appeared and saved Prahlad because of his devotion, and Holika was burnt in the fire. The second story is based on Lord Krishna. Since Lord Krishna had dark complexion, he always wondered why his companion Radha was very fair. So he approached his mother Yashoda for a suggestion. Mother Yashoda suggested Krishna to apply colors on Radha's face, and through this he can change her skin tone to any color of his choice. Fascinated by this idea, Krishna proceeded to do so and thus introduced the festival. Holi is generally celebrated for 2 to 3 days. A day before Holi is called Holika Dahan. On this day, people come out of their homes and gather at a public place. They light fire during night, which signifies the burning of Holika, a symbol of evil. Holi also symbolizes the victory of good over evil. On the day of Holi, friends and families get together and play Holi with colors. Now, I would request Kamini ma'am to talk about the other aspects of this festival.
Good morning, all. While Holi is a festival of colors, celebration of any festival is incomplete without delicious food. Different types of delicacies are prepared throughout India to bring in the zeal and enthusiasm of celebrating Holi. The common items which are prepared in most of the homes are the gujiyas made of sugar and khoya. Then the soft and lusty puran polis with lots of ghee upon it, and also thandai, a drink made of milk, sugar and spices. Ideally, Holi is a celebration of colors. It is also a symbol of harmony and brotherhood. However, recently it has been losing its aesthetic values because of the commercialization and degradation of environmental factors. Natural colors have been replaced with synthetic colors. These colors are made of toxic materials which are harmful for our body. It may cause eye irritation, skin allergies, or even respiratory problems. However, we can still enjoy the traditional way of Holi by using natural, herbal, and non-toxic colors, which can be easily made by preparing, which can be easily prepared by using natural ingredients like flowers, leaves, and fruits. We can make use of flowers like hibiscus, marigold, and also use herbs like haldi, turmeric, and sandal. We all like to enjoy Holi, or at least watching others playing Holi. However, there are certain unwanted things happening which hamper the celebration of festival. To avoid this, we can follow certain regulations like not throwing water balloons at people, avoid using harmful metallic colors, avoid loud and rowdy parties that spoil the family environment, and spare animals from throwing colors. We should remember the purpose of Holi, that is uniting people and victory of evil. The main purpose of Holi is that people come together, forgetting their past rivalries and tensions, to share compassion, peace, care, and joy. We should play Holi with only willing people and do not apply colors forcibly. Try to make use of herbal colors only, and most importantly, do not waste water to play Holi. As we all know, International World Water Day and Holi fall in the same month, that is March. International World Water Day is held every year on 22nd March to focus attention on importance of fresh water and advocating measures for management of water resources. You'll notice that more than 60% of people in Maharashtra are facing water shortages. Around 15 districts are affected with drought. There are places in Maharashtra which get water supply only once in 10 days. However, on the background of this, it is alarming to note that an individual wastes around 200 liters of water during Holi. It is not only really alarming, but also an awakening call for us to consider the importance of saving water. Let's pledge together to play a dry Holi and a safe Holi. Wish you all a very happy and colorful Holi in advance. Thank you.